Hello there, very good afternoon. It's now less than 2 weeks to go until Britain has a brand new Prime Minister. But whoever wins the battle for number 10 then has another battle on their hands, tackling soaring inflation and the cost of living crisis, with household bills set to skyrocket this autumn. Well, to tell us more is Russ Mould from AJ Bell. A warm welcome back, and you're going to be telling us what this new leader needs to do to sort the British economy out, because whoever wins, Russ, well, they've got a tough job on their hands, right?
Yeah, I wouldn't dare presume. I think I'll leave that to the Conservative Party members to decide who's going to make the big decisions. That's thankfully beyond my remit. But yeah, they have some enormous challenges ahead. Inflation, though, again, in theory, that's the Bank of England's job, though Liz Truss seems to be possibly rethinking that, shall we say. She's certainly planning an emergency budget and getting rid of the Office for Budget Responsibility Statistics in the meantime. So inflation is one key challenge. The Bank of England's forecast of a recession being imminent, which again, mistrust has pushed back on quite forcefully, saying that isn't guaranteed and things can be done. And that's not just down to what's happening in the UK. We've got the US slowing down, Europe, one of our biggest trading partners, slowing down. China is cutting interest rates and trying to stimulate its economy. So there's a big challenge there. And both inflation and the economy, as much a prey to global forces as they are domestic ones. So any new prime minister may be able to exert some influence, but not perhaps as much as they would like. And from a stock market perspective, we've had midterm prime ministers before, John Brown, Gordon Major, Theresa May, Boris Johnson, dare one say. And if you look at what the UK stock market's done in response, not much, generally speaking. It's generally taken that change in its stride. And ultimately, stock markets are long-term discounting mechanisms priced off corporate cash flows. So if you are looking for what impact a prime minister can have on your portfolio, it's will they look at any specific industries where they may, for example, look to regulate more, tax more, regulate less, or tax less? Mm-hmm. Or, yeah, will they come up with policies that may have some impact upon the economy? I'm sure their goal is positive, but there are occasionally unintended consequences.
And what's the main difference then in their approach? So we've got Truss wants to cut interest rates and Sunak doesn't, right? Is that pretty much it? How do you see it?
I mean, the clearest delineation seems to be Liz Truss is in favour of broad tax cuts for everybody, a reversal of the national insurance increase, I believe, and also a reversal of the planned increase in corporation tax that comes in next April. Rishi Sunak seems to be in favour of a more tailored approach. He's already come out with that £37 billion package in the budget in the spring, designed to help households that needed it most. And he's talking about a more measured approach, less freebies for everybody, if you could say, because he's of the view the budget deficit is already too high. And as interest rates go up, I think he's quoted that number before, every percentage point on the Bank of England base rate is £25 billion on the government's interest bill. And let's face it, that will pay for an awful lot of schools, bridges, hospitals, and indeed essential staff. So he's coming from the camp that there just isn't the money there, the room for manoeuvre that we would like to have. Liz Truss seems to be coming from the camp of actually, let's just spend it and we'll see what we can do about it and get it back through economic growth further down the path.
And whose approach do you favour then, Russ?
Again, I try and stay out of politics and I try and stick to the markets, but I think looking at it from a classical economics point of view, I can see where Liz Truss is coming from, but I think the challenge that she'll face is that, yes, you can stimulate demand, but in some cases, supply remains a key problem with fractured global supply chains, and boosting economic growth will boost demand for oil and gas at a time when their prices are already very firm. So there may be a short-term fillip there, but we're just coming out of the biggest stimulus that we've ever seen, monetary and fiscal. And I think to assume that we can compensate for that and keep that party going, I think is probably optimistic.
And let's maybe go back to inflation, because there's various numbers kicking around today. We've all heard the 18% projection for next year. Russ, what does that look like?
I mean, if 18% would be a return to the 1970s, and they weren't a particularly great time unless you're a Leeds United or a Bay City Rollers fan, from an investment point of view, they were extremely difficult. The only asset that really did well in the 1970s was gold. And that was partly because it started at $35 an ounce before Richard M. Nixon, the then US president, withdrew the dollar from Bretton Woods in 1971. So even there, you've got to bear in mind the starting point. But equities had a very difficult decade in inflation-adjusted terms. Bonds and cash did even worse. And that was partly because the Bank of England, the government as it was, and it was the Chancellor of the Exchequer who decided where interest rates would go. And they actually took interest rates between them up into the high teens in the early 1980s. And if you look at where UK inflation is now at around 9.5%, 10%, the last time inflation was there under Chancellor Nigel Lawson, UK interest rates were 12, 13, 14%. Now, given the national debt, given mortgage debt, credit card debt, the UK economy would simply not stand that degree of a tight monetary policy. So although the Bank of England might like to think it can talk a good game, its room for manoeuvre in terms of how far it can take interest rates before something breaks the economy is actually relatively limited.
Mm-hmm. And how much of this can be controlled? Because we've got external factors, Russia's invasion of Ukraine. How much can the government actually do to stem this crisis?
A lot of the inflation at the moment comes from oil and gas and energy, where the candidates do have their plans in various shapes and forms. What they can actually do about the underlying oil and gas prices is a difficult issue. If you look normally, you know, if you're a believer in free markets, you would say, well, the best cure for high prices is high prices, because they either stimulate supply or persuade people to reduce demand or look for alternative sources. Now, stimulating supply of oil and gas is not politically popular. We've had the big ESG movement for understandable ecological environmental reasons in the last 10 years. The public is not baying for more oil and gas right now. And so oil companies have listened. They've actually been drilling less than they ever have done for the last 20 odd years, if you look at their capital investment to sales ratios. So there's no big onrush of fresh oil supply there. So if you want more oil, then we have to go to Moscow or Tehran or Caracas and ask for more, which I think politically is extremely unpalatable right now. Mm-hmm. Or you then need to try and find some alternative source of energy, which we're already working on with gas, with wind, solar and others. But that's not a quick fix either. Mm-hmm. So you're not really looking at a big increase in supply. You're therefore going down the demand destruction route, which is a recession, which maybe seems where the Bank of England's coming from right now. And you've seen Europe saying we're going to reduce our gas consumption by 15 to 20%, running cold baths, switching off neon signs in France and all those other things that they're experimenting with. So that is one other possibility if markets are left to run their course, but no quick solutions either way there and some pain to be taken along the way.
Yeah, quite right. Depressing stuff. Russ Mould, thank you so much from AJ Bell here on Proactive London this afternoon.